Welcome back, everyone. After the break, we have Professor Daniel Figueroa joining us for a second lecture on gravitational waves. Daniel.
All right. Thank you very much. Okay. Thanks a lot. Welcome, everybody. It's a great pleasure to be back with all of you. Today, we are going to continue with our second lecture on cosmological backgrounds of gravitational waves. Where we left it yesterday, no, from the first lecture, we had a study, two approaches to define gravitational waves. First approach based on so-called linearized gravity, Minkowski. Then we did a more general approach, which is based on the scalar vector tensor decomposition. We did it over Minkowski, but it can be done over any background that has isotropy, okay? Because scalar vectors and tensors relate to how they transform and their rotations. And finally, there was a third approach that we didn't have time to go through, which we're gonna deal with it right now before we move on the topics. No? So let's continue with this third definition of gravitational waves. This is going to be an attempt to give like a most general definition of gravitational waves, at least at a perturbative level. So we are going to consider that there is we are dealing with a curved space-time in full generality. And now we are going to decompose our generic metric, space-time metric tensor into a background metric plus a perturbation. We still demand that this is much smaller than one, although now it's more ambiguous, this decomposition, you know, because of course it's not clear what are the entries here, no? So maybe a more natural definition would be to demand is much smaller than the largest entries here of the background metric. If you want another way to proceed, you could assume there is an epsilon parameter here, which we assume is very small, you know, and then we will count powers of this epsilon parameter. At the end of the day, this is what it means, this kind of expansion. So this is really a more subtle problem than before, because before it was clear that because we were preserving Minkowski at the background level, then all space-time dependence was in the perturbation. And this is what led in first place to the notion of infinitesimal general transformation that we over which we impose a specific condition over the displacement vector such that we would preserve always the background as being Minkowski. And we would always move from one system of reference to another preserving Minkowski. Now we cannot do that because there is time dependence in the background itself. And hence this is more subtle because if I do a transformation of coordinates, I will change the perturbation, but then I will also change what I mean by the background. Okay, and this is a real problem. So we have to think of something else other than just the separation of relative amplitudes. Okay, and what is the solution that some people proposed in the early 60s? Well, let us think of a separation of scales. What I mean by this is that not only we are going to consider that there is a hierarchy between the typical amplitude entries of my background metric and my typical perturbation elements, but also we are gonna consider that my perturbation, has a wavelength much shorter than the typical length scale of variation of this background metric. Or in an equivalent manner, this guy, the perturbation, lives in a high frequency domain versus a low frequency domain characterizing a low frequency time dependence characterization of the background metric. Okay, I'm gonna use alternatively short wavelength versus long scale or high frequency versus low frequency for doing this separation. So it turns out that it is crucial actually to do this separation of scales if we want to define properly some meaning attached to not only gravitational waves, but also what energy and momentum and other properties gravitational waves carry. Why is that? Well, let's consider our Einstein equations, famous Einstein equations. Now I write them in this particular form. Instead of having in the left-hand side the Einstein tensor, now I maintain the Ricci tensor here for convenience, which is a absolutely fine operation, because then I, instead of having the Einstein tensor here, now I'm going to have the trace reverse metric, trace reverse energy momentum tensor in the right hand side. All right. So essentially, the Einstein equations, you can always write them as the Einstein tensor equal to the energy momentum tensor, or the Ricci tensor equal to the trace reverse energy momentum tensor, for the simple reason that the Einstein tensor is the Ricci trace reverse Ricci tensor. Okay. Now let's write Einstein equations like this and do an expansion, a perturbative expansion over powers, counting powers of this metric perturbation. As I said before, you could think of it as introducing an epsilon parameter here and just counting powers of that epsilon parameter. So we're going to have a background part that has no epsilon dependence. We're going to have an order one part. We're going to have an order two part, and so on and so forth if we wanted to continue with this expansion. We're going to cut it at second order because we don't need to go further. So let's decompose now the equations of motion, the dynamics of gravity, instead of based on this power series expansion. Let's decompose it now between, let's say, long scale or low frequency and high frequency short scale. So first, let's look at the long scale. So there is the background Ricci tensor. This is just built from the background metric using the definition of Ricci tensor. And now we see that in the right-hand side, we place here a low part. This means low frequency. Part of the trace reverse energy momentum tensor. So if we think in general of our energy momentum tensor, say for instance, as being responsible for the expansion of the universe, has a cosmological scale, and also responsible for creating gravitational waves locally that has a very small wavelength, here we are only putting the background part, okay, the low frequency or long scale. And the second order part of the Ricci tensor, which is built by quadratic forms of the metric perturbation, this could involve derivatives or products of them, etc., actually may have naturally a low part, a low frequency part. Why is that? Because if you think of two high frequency fields and you multiply them, there is the possibility of having through convolution the annihilation almost equal out of phase, you know, such that the survival mode out of the product of these two, it's only a low frequency one. Okay, and this is a well-known aspect known from you know, field theory or even wave dynamics, that you can produce a low frequency mode out of the product of two high frequency modes. And this is why we believe the second order part may contain some low frequency part that I should equate to this guy and to compensate with this guy. However, not the first order part. Okay, the first order part should have its own equation, because on the one hand, it represents, of course, the linear expansion of the Ricci tensor, which naturally contains this metric perturbation that we are going to assume a hard frequency. And then it contains the high frequency part of the second order expansion. So obviously, when I multiply two high frequency perturbations, naturally, very often, the result also will be high frequency. And also, as I said before, I can think that my general energy momentum tensor has a low part and a high frequency part. Okay, low and high is in terms of frequency. Otherwise, it would be large, and this would be small, referring to wavelengths. I hope this is clear. So let us focus, first of all, in the long scale, low frequency part. We write it here. We zoom in. So background Ricci tensor equal to low frequency part of second order, low frequency part of energy momentum tensor. Well, what is the natural way to extract from a product of functions, say each function has its own frequency or a wavelength, what is the low frequency part of that product? Or if you want, what is the long wavelength part of that product? Well, the natural way to do that, actually, if you recall actually your textbooks from classical mechanics or electromagnetism, is to do a volume average. A volume average, if you want to just rescue the behavior of a long wavelength, or a time average if what you want to rescue is the low frequency behavior. And you do the average up to a scale that is in between the long scale, the low frequency characterizing the background, and the high frequency characterizing the perturbation. So this is very similar to renormalization ideas in quantum field theory, where you introduce a renormalization scale and you want to integrate out over high momentum modes, but you don't want your physics to depend on the choice of your intermediate scale, your renormalization scale. This is very similar. I choose this scale and I take volume average over this perturbation. Since this scale in wavelength is much larger than the wavelength of the perturbation, then it doesn't really matter what intermediate scale I choose, as long as it's in between. Okay, the system is going to be independent of that. And this is very nice. This is really very nice because it allows me immediately to define a kind of energy momentum tensor related to this low frequency part or long wavelength part of the second order Ricci expansion. Essentially, by construction, I can build an energy momentum tensor of this form that has this shape with the volume average brackets here or the time dependent volume time average in depending if you are in a space or time domain. And at the same time, I apply the same average, of course, to the energy momentum tensor. And that way we are rescuing the background contribution, which therefore we can write as the background, literally the construction of the trace reverse energy momentum tensor from the background metric. Okay, for instance, in the context of the whole universe, this would be the energy momentum tensor of the perfect fluid that dictates the expansion of the universe, depending on what era of the expansion we are. Okay, I hope the idea is clear because you see, once you have defined this object based on the introduction of the volume average, then it's fantastic because I can rewrite my low frequency, long scale Einstein equations, so the background Ricci equal to the background energy momentum tensor plus this special energy momentum tensor based on the volume or time averages over the second order Ricci scalar Ricci tensor expansion, okay, built in this way. Which, okay, as is written here, also requires the second order expansion of the Ricci scalar, which is nothing else but the trace of the Ricci tensor. So those expressions are, of course, very complicated. I'm not going to show the derivation of them in terms of metric perturbations. But luckily, at the end of the day, after quite a number of manipulations and taking this volume / time averages, you end writing, surprisingly, the expectation value of this guy, of the second order expansion of the Ricci tensor, in this kind of simple manner, which essentially allows me to define immediately what I mean by this energy momentum tensor associated to these perturbations. And as you can imagine, since we are now associating an energy momentum tensor to the perturbations through this second order, we are going to expect that this is the energy momentum tensor associated to the propagating degrees of freedom of gravity, which we know are the gravitons, and that we identified yesterday in a Minkowski background as the transverse degrees of freedom. But as I said, that identification can be made in actually any background that is isotropic, like, for instance, Friedman-Lemaître, Robertson-Walker, the background describing the universe. And therefore, we are going to associate this energy momentum tensor to our gravitational waves. But we are not going to do that actually because we just want to. It's that actually mathematically, if you carry on with this computation and you do the compositions and take into account that there are derivatives here and volume and time averages, you end actually discovering that only transverse trailless degrees of freedom contribute to this average, at least at sub-horizon scales, okay?
There is a question in the chat from Robert Brandenberger.
Yes.
Which asks, are you doing the average by using Percival's theorem and taking only the low frequency modes?
To be honest, Robert, I'm not specifying here at this point how we are proceeding with the average, because as you know very well, because you work on these expansions, no, yourself in the late 90s and recently with Tomo and probably other papers. It's a bit subtle how to define this. So yeah, I don't know. Maybe if you want to give some clarification on this, I was not intending to.
Robert, I have unmuted you. You have to unmute and speak. You can unmute and speak. Yeah, please go ahead, Robert.
Robert?
Yeah, so I hear what he said. Thanks. It's a subtle point.
A subtle point, yeah. How I do it myself, in a work I'm doing now recently, actually, since we are locked down by the pandemic, I've been working a lot on this problem. And I'm just doing, you know, standard volume averages over the second order expansion without much more care. Yeah, I know it's subtle and I don't have a clear answer to give you. I don't know if you have something clear to say.
But in this spatial average, then you only keep the high frequency Fourier modes.
No, in reality, I'm keeping them all. The point is I'm averaging over a volume that has a length scale larger than the typical wavelength of the perturbations I have.
I see. So on those scales, then the short wavelength fluctuations average.
That's right. That's the idea. That's precisely the idea of this averaging procedure, that it filters out, it kind of averages out the high frequency mode. So I'm not separating my fluctuations into long wavelength and short wavelength. I assume my fluctuations, they have short wavelength, but I also assume that when I build some of these bilinear terms of the second order expansion, when I take the volume average, some part survives, but that part has naturally a long wavelength from the volume average procedure, you know, and any remaining part of the high frequency oscillatory behavior of the second order expansion dies away from this volume average. That's the idea.
Okay, thanks.
That's my understanding, Robert, at least. I think I'll be very happy to talk to you and to Tomo at some point, okay? Because as I said, I'm really working on this on my own now, and I have some doubts. But since it's a subtle topic, if you want, maybe we can postpone at most for questions tomorrow, if you want. If that's fine.
Sure.
Okay, thank you. Then, as we said, we take a volume average, which has certain subtleties, but the point, for instance, you can find in, for instance, in Michele Maiore's first volume on gravitational waves, you can find that he demonstrates how, at least taking ordinary volume or time integration, only the transversalized degrees of freedom survive, as you would expect, actually, you know, because you have identified them with the real propagating degrees of freedom. So this allows you to define an energy momentum tensor, this little t here, which therefore allow us to define what is the energy density spectrum or the energy emitted by the gravitational waves per unit of area and time. And from here, of course, what's the energy density spectrum? What is the total energy density associated to gravitational waves? So again, you do your decomposition, a scalar vector tensor. You take just the tensor part, which is the transverse traceless part. Take these time derivatives, at least in sub-horizon scales, this is absolutely correct. And if you take a volume average or a time average over a wavelength larger than the typical wavelength of these fluctuations, this defines the fusion of the energy density of gravitational waves. You can associate an energy density as contributing to the background Ricci tensor. And for instance, in the universe as contributing, if you want, to the expansion of the universe. As small as this energy density might be, you can take its contribution in order to put bounds to the presence of a stochastic background of gravitational waves. Okay. So what about the high frequency short scale modes? So remember that there is the other side of the equation, which is the first order expansion of the Ricci tensor equal to the high frequency part of the second order expansion. and equal to the high frequency part of the energy momentum tensor. And now I don't need to take any volume average because I'm literally taking whatever the fluctuations are with their small wavelength. By immediate inspection of order of magnitude scaling with their wavelength and so on, you immediately realize that how this is built, this second order high frequency part is completely suppressed to the first order part of the Ricci tensor. It's suppressed by the wavelength of the perturbations over the background length scale. So essentially we can ignore this. It would be a tiny correction in most cases in principle. And then we can just focus on the equation given by the first order expansion of the Ricci tensor as equal to the high frequency part of the energy momentum tensor. Now, I can write explicitly this expansion, and voila, this resembles pretty much what we had seen when we did the expansion over Minkowski. If you remember, we had these three terms over Minkowski, with the difference now that now I have covariant derivatives, where the covariant derivative is the gravitational covariant derivative as taken with the background Christopher symbols. All right, that's the only difference, but it's the expected difference. And other than that, the shape is the same. The three different functional terms are the same, which immediately invites me to define a Lorentz gauge in now this curve space-time. So we're gonna define it as the divergence-less with the covariant gravitational derivative over the trace reverse metric. Sorry, I forgot to say this delta G mu with bar is again the trace reverse metric version in this curve space-time. If you go back to the transparencies yesterday, you will see it's absolutely the same form, but now with covariant derivatives and the background metric. Very nice, so if I can do that, I can do the same trick as yesterday. So I eliminate the terms that take that cross derivative indexes with the metric, and I'm left with this box operator over my background metric over the trace reverse metric perturbations. And this is what describes the propagation of gravitational waves in curved spacetime. Of course, we know that in order to identify, because we already said this many times and we demonstrated with a Minkowski background yesterday, in order to identify really the gravitational waves in this equation, we need to take a step further, do the decomposition in scalar vector tensor parts, and keep only the tensor part that is the transverse traceless degrees of freedom. And when you do that, then you are fully describing the gravitational wave propagating degrees of freedom in the context of a background metric, as long as these guys are a perturbation compared to that metric. That is a very good approximation in the context that really concerns us, which is the universe. There is a background metric, which is the Friedmann-Lemaitre Robertson-Walker, which has a time scale or a length scale, if you want, which is the Hubble scale. And then we are gonna have gravitational waves produced inside the universe, which have much smaller wavelengths, of course, typically, and they are gonna propagate according to this wave equation in that curved background. And of course, if there is matter, once again, we know the trick. We have to take the transverse traceless part of the matter part. This is what this really means. Imagine you have this high frequency. This was represented by this, pi mu nu, typically called an isotropic stress. And now I have to take the transverse traceless part to really identify that with the source of gravitational waves, of the truly radiative degrees of freedom of the metric perturbation. And this game I can play in the context of the universe pretty much as I showed yesterday in Minkowski. So before we move on actually into applying this to specific cases, let me give for clarity how this looks like in the context of the expanding universe. So in a Friedmann-Lemaitre Robertson-Walker metric, which is described here by this line element, plus a perturbation, which is transverse traceless directly, because we are only gonna focus on gravitational waves, doesn't mean there are not other perturbations. It only means I want to focus on transverse traceless degrees of freedom, which are linear order. Remember, they are gauge invariant, and they are not coupled to the rest of perturbations. So essentially, we linearize Einstein equations. We just showed it before in an abstract manner. And this is what we have for the linear, the Ricci tensor to first order. You see now we have a wave equation, which has the standard wave part plus a friction term due to the expansion of the universe, where this H is nothing else but the Hubble rate here in conformal time, as I'm writing this equation. And the source is nothing else but the transverse stressless part of what we call the anisotropic stress, which is any deviation of the full energy momentum tensor compared to the perfect fluid energy momentum tensor responsible for the expansion of the universe. Okay. So what is the game we can play now as cosmologists, as a field theorist, as a theoretical physicist? We can look, or we are going to look for situations in the early universe where in a non-trivial manner, we are gonna develop, we are gonna excite scalar fields, which are gonna develop large gradients. And we're gonna build this anisotropic stress, take the transverse stressless part of it. And if it's non-zero, which will happen in certain situations, whenever there are non-trivial gradients, then we have a natural source for gravitational waves. And the same goes for gauge fields, where you see there's an electric and magnetic contribution, let it be abelian or non-abelian, this doesn't matter. And the same goes even for fermions, even though, of course, creating gradients of fermions is more difficult at the level of the fermionic field because of the Pauli exclusion principle. Okay? But still, they also gravitate and hence emit gravitational waves. Okay, so we are about to start with the next part. We are going to focus on the first second of the universe. Maybe before I move on, I'm happy to see if somebody has any question. And I take the chance to have a sip of water.
So there is a question, Danny.
Yes.
It says, are the energy density rho GW and zero zero component of the energy momentum tensor defined identical?
Of the energy momentum tensor that I define from the second order Ricci tensor, yes, modulo scale factor coefficients, which depend on your choice of time variable. Okay, it's not the same, the identification you do. There's a proportionality based on some power of the scale factor, which depends on whether you are in conformal time, in cosmic time, or in alpha time. Okay, but other than that, yes. Yes. Yeah. My pleasure. Okay. Any other question?
Are there any other questions? Please raise your hand and you can ask the question directly. There are none for now, then.
There are none for now. Very good. Okay, excellent. So now we start the official part of the second lecture, no? Since the definition of gravitational waves in reality belong to the former lecture, but in any case, these are just levels, doesn't really matter what we call lecture or not. So we're gonna start now with studying gravitational waves from inflation and from what we call preheating, and I will specify what that is. First of all, basics of inflation. So inflation is, I would say, but for sure, maybe other people in this audience, I'm not sure they agree fully with this, but I would say is the leading candidate to explain the early universe or to cure some of the problems we have in the absence of inflation with the standard hot Big Bang picture. So in particular, inflation cures in a very natural way the problems of homogeneity, isotropy of the hot Big Bang theory, explains in a natural way in this manner the cosmological principle, and this is what led initially Alan Guth to identify the inflationary mechanism as a mechanism to cure the problems of the Big Bang paradigm. No, but then it became soon after the proposal of Guth, it became clear that, first of all, other people had already proposed inflation without maybe being so much aware that what inflation was capable of doing in terms of solving the hot Big Bang problems. For instance, Starobinsky inflation, no, was proposed before the seminal paper of Guth. But in any case, what became clear 1 year after Guth's seminal paper is that inflation, also it's a natural generator or natural mechanism to generate the initial conditions of the universe. And by this, I mean the primordial perturbations that we see in the universe or we expect to see. Particularly, we do see the scalar ones. We've measured them very well in the cosmic microwave background. And there's also a natural prediction in inflation in the most general standard basic picture of inflation, where tensor perturbation gravitational waves are also produced. Now, explaining all of this are the basics of inflation, right? Obviously, I'm pretty much aware that you've been following lectures by Will Kinney on inflation precisely. Plus, there are lectures by David Wands also on perturbations, which I'm guessing he also dealt a little bit probably with inflationary origin. Plus, there are lectures by Masahide on the early universe in general. I'm guessing he may also touch these aspects. So originally, I was preparing a primer on inflation, but since I believe with the lectures of Kinney and other lecturers, it's more than well explained, all these basic aspects. And because also we dedicated some time today to explain the third definition of gravitational waves, I think I'm gonna skip this primer on gravitational waves. We're gonna skip it and we are gonna assume that you've been given a nice explanation of the origin of scalar and tensor perturbations in inflation. Am I correct in assuming this, guys? Or maybe you want me later on to give some more explanation? Yes,
both Will and David have discussed generation of scalar and tensor perturbation during inflation.
Fantastic, fantastic, fantastic. Therefore, I'm gonna skip these basics, you know, because it would be too much of an overlap. I'm gonna consider you are already quite familiar with the general idea of inflation. And I'm gonna focus more on the fact that these tensor perturbations that probably David and Will have presented just as a spectrum of tensor perturbation, it's really a stochastic gravitational wave background. Okay, and I'm gonna try to dwell a little bit on that. So let's review what probably you've learned already in these other lectures. During inflation, if you take your full metric and you decompose it into background metric, the one creating the quasi-exponential expansion responsible for inflation, and you introduce fluctuations, or you decompose your metric in such a manner that now you consider there are fluctuations. If we focus on the transverse traceless degrees of freedom, which we know we identify with gravitational waves, and we know transverse traceless simply means this, here I'm assuming summing over repeated indexes, it turns out that quantum effects, this is what you are supposed to have learned, I hope, very well in the other lectures, quantum fluctuations, really due to a quantum effect, make these metric perturbations, in particular here we focus on the transverse traceless part, to fluctuate. And it fluctuates at a microscopic level, okay, very deep inside the Hubble radius, initially very deep inside the Hubble radius, such that the fluctuations are symmetric, so the mean value of these fluctuations is zero, but there is yet a variance between positive and negative fluctuations. And this variance, here in Fourier space, is what we call the power spectrum. And the power spectrum is given, you can very easily calculate it. This is very standard to calculate it in these basic notions of inflation. And I really hope you were guided to arrive to this formula. This power spectrum at the end of the day in a slow roll, okay, in the approximation of a slow roll or quasi slow roll, which is a good approximation, of course, for many scenarios. at the end of the day, the important thing is the amplitude of this variant, which is characterized by this guy, the power spectrum, is proportional to the Hubble rate of inflation, which is nothing else but another variable for codifying what's the energy scale of inflation. And this is why this background of tensors from inflation is so relevant. Because if we could measure it, not only this would be possibly the best manner to demonstrate inflation, although of course in that there can be quite some debate, okay? But certainly would be very, very strong point towards validating inflation, but also it would allow us to know the energy scale of inflation. And this is why the search for this background is so relevant, and there are actually so many experiments looking for it. So now, if this spectrum is like that at super horizon scales, once the modes cross the horizon, they have a radius during inflation, we can propagate these tensor modes through cosmic history. Actually, I think in my primer, I think I have a small diagram here. So you see during inflation, the comoving Hubble radius shrinks, and then the quantum fluctuating wavelength exits the comoving Hubble radius. Then after inflation, it remains frozen as super Hubble mode and eventually re-enters the Hubble radius during a standard evolution much later, way later on during the late evolution of the universe, way after inflation. And then in that moment that we had a static spectrum, in that moment, it becomes a proper background of gravitational waves since the modes start oscillating with what the starting amplitude, the one given by this spectrum. So essentially, you can compute nowadays what is the energy density spectrum of this background of gravitational waves that after they cross the Hubble radius during the late expansion of the universe, they start propagating as relativistic gravitational waves according to the relativistic wave equations I showed before. And it turns out that at least for the modes that cross during radiation domination era of the universe, the amplitude of the spectrum, the energy density per logarithmic mode normalized to the critical energy today, it's trivial. It's just given by the power spectrum we computed before times something we call a transfer function, which for radiation domination is just a constant. And it's just a suppression due to the omega rad parameter, no? The fraction of radiation degrees of freedom to the critical energy density in the universe today. This means that the energy density spectrum today has the same shape, at least for the modes that cross during radiation domination, which are the most relevant ones we'll see in a moment, has the same functional shape as this power spectrum that you have learned in your lessons of inflation. And as I said, and I reinforce it again, this power spectrum is proportional to the Hubble rate, to the energy scale of inflation. And it has, this I didn't mention before, it has some small scale dependence through a small tilt, a small red tilt, which is suppressed, this tilt, by a slow roll parameter, which is typically much smaller than that. So how does it look, this spectrum? Well, this is a cartoonish picture, but it really captures the idea. This is the amplitude of the omega gravitational waves today. Remember, that's the logarithmic spectrum of gravitational waves normalized to critical energy density versus frequency today. If I take no slow roll approximation, then this is a purely scale invariant background. If I introduce this tilt due to a slow roll suppression, then we see that there is this very small red tilt, okay? Which nowadays, given the constraints from CMB, it's a very small tilt. It's really a very small tilt. Now, well, you see, this is quasi-scale invariant. We could talk about quasi-scale invariants, except for the frequency modes that enter during matter domination, that they scale rather in a fully scale-dependent manner as k to minus 2. But looking at this quasi-scale invariant spectrum, okay, what is relevant for you guys? What is relevant for you in this plot I'm showing? What would you highlight of this plot? Okay, and here, let me specify that this is possibly the maximum amplitude you can think of this background. What comes to your mind when you see this plot? Anybody?
Well,
please raise your hand if you have a comment to make.
Yeah, or just comment on the chat. What comes to your mind? Okay, I'll tell you what comes to my mind. This is an impressive spectrum that spans many decades in frequency. That makes it a very powerful tool because hopefully could be probed at many different scales. If it weren't, because I'm plotting you here, the would-be, advanced LIGO sensitivity once it goes into the ultimate design, or the would-be sensitivity for detection of LISA once it flies to space, and this background is order of magnitude below these experiments, okay? Exactly. For one, it looks like we won't be able to detect it with LIGO or LISA, or for that matter, any other direct detection experiment that has been really thought in a serious manner and is put over the table as an experiment coming in the near future, even if near means maybe 20, 30 years. So this is not directly observable. Our only chance, in principle, is perhaps, if we are lucky, to observe it at the CMB, at the cosmic microwave background, because the B mode of the polarization field of the cosmic photons of the CMB actually is a nice proof of tensor and vector perturbations. And seen in inflation, there are only tensor perturbations, is a direct proof of this background of tensor modes. Okay. I hope we'll cover something of this. Let me know, otherwise we can always discuss about it. Now, notice that I said the transfer function, it was a scale independent for radiation domination. But when did the universe become radiation dominated? We don't know. This has to do with when reheating ends. So since we don't know, we can also pretty much parameterize the transfer function of the modes crossing between the end of inflation and the onset of radiation domination, and characterize that intermediate period, let it be reheating or even something else, by an effective equation of state. And it turns out that if this equation of state is stiff, as which really means bigger than 1/3, which is the value associated to radiation fluid, this is the case in some reheating scenarios, for instance. Well, if you have this situation, it turns out that the would-be quasi-scale invariant background is not a scale invariant anymore. It uplifts its tail, its UV, the ultraviolet part, the short wavelength part, and it looks rather like this. It has a plateau. Here is the spectrum again versus frequency. It has a plateau in the radiation-dominated modes that cross during radiation domination, and it has a tilt branch which can have a very large slope. How large the tilt? As large as the equation of a state can be here, which should not be larger than one, you can see. Okay, so at most it can be one, but that makes it quasi observable because it could cross through LIGO or through LISA. Now what happened? We haven't observed nothing with LIGO, so that already puts strong constraints, and we also need to make it compatible with the amount of radiation we can tolerate during big band nucleosynthesis, and this requires, depending on the energy scale of inflation, that the equation of a state of this parameterized era in between inflation and radiation domination is not very large, which means that the possibility to observe it at LIGO doesn't exist, but at LISA, it does exist, but it's tiny, I'm afraid, actually. It only corresponds to this tiny parameter space corresponding to very contrived values of the equation of a state. It's still possible to observe it, but not very appealing, I would say. So I'm happy to continue any moment. Shall I?
You can restart, Jen. Please.
Thank you. All right. So what we've discussed here is that during inflation, just because of quantum mechanics, if inflation is characterized by a quasi-de Sitter space-time background, there is necessarily what I call an irreducible background of gravitational waves, which is this quasi-scale invariant background, which of course, depending on the equation of a state of the universe after inflation, it might develop a tilt or not, but otherwise it's quasi-scale invariant, at least for the modes crossing during radiation domination. But inflation, this is probably the virtue of inflation, but also its own problem, that also a problem, no? That is a very flexible paradigm. And in model building, when you enter into model building, you can really consider many different aspects. And in particular, one can add like extra field species or invoke whatever other symmetries that have not been invoked, consider enhancement of scalar perturbations due to features in the potential, consider modified gravity, spectator fields, graviton mass that someone was asking about yesterday, etc. I'm gonna focus on few of these, you know, just few, because otherwise, you know, we would never finish and we really need to move on also into other parts of the lecture. Let me start by considering this idea of extra species involved in the inflationary setup, in particular invoking a very special symmetry, which is the so-called shift symmetry. We are gonna consider that our inflaton respects, to some extent, this shift symmetry. This symmetry is actually broken by its own potential, but the advantage of having this shift symmetry at almost realized in your Lagrangian is that in principle radiative corrections protect, the potential is protected from radiative corrections. Now, whether it's consistent or not to take a potential and then invoke the shift symmetry depends on the origin of this field and the physics. I'm not gonna enter into that. I'm just gonna consider there is a potential and appealing to this shift symmetry, we are gonna introduce a coupling to an extra species which is a gauge field. So the gauge field has a field strength, F mu nu, and you can build F tilde invariant quantity times this axion, this inflaton, which is like an axion-like field. Okay, we are gonna consider it's an axion-like field. This is called action inflation. And this kind of coupling is natural from shift symmetry. It was already introduced in this context by some people 10 years ago and studied in full detail in the last 10 years by a lot of people. I put here just a couple of references, the very original one, and then some nice study, but there's been in reality quite a number of studies about this. Okay, I'm not gonna be systematic citing them. So I only want to explain the physics. So the physics is very simple. We think of our gauge field now, which gives rise to this F mu nu, and we write down the equation of motion of our gauge field, which we decompose into polarizations. Let me think of the abelian case. So let's think of a photon-like gauge field, not the photon of the standard model, okay, of the electromagnetism, just a generic gauge field. It has two ellipses, plus and minus. And when you write down the equation of motion and decompose into the ellipses, you realize that the two ellipses are different, their dynamics. And the reason for this is because this coupling is chiral and differentiates one ellipse from the other, as it can be seen in this plus and minus sign depending on the ellipse. So what happens is that if you take the plus sign, this parameter size is negative, typically negative. It could, if it's positive, then you take the minus sign. Okay, this depends on your setup. The point is one of the ellipses is going to be tachyonic necessarily because of this differentiation, which comes from the nature of this interaction, which implies that during inflation, there's gonna be a chiral instability. Instability because the amplitude of the gauge field is gonna grow exponentially fast, and chiral because only one polarization and not the other is gonna be amplified. And this is extremely interesting because if I amplify a gauge field during inflation, which has a non-trivial spectrum, and if you want a non-trivial energy momentum tensor, and hence a non-trivial transverse traceless part of that energy momentum tensor. That non-trivial part is the transverse traceless part of the electric and magnetic configuration of this gauge field, which is chiral because only one of its polarizations is active, which implies that not only we are going to create, because it's a natural source of gravitational waves, not only we are gonna create tensor modes, source tensor modes, on top of the other from vacuum fluctuations, but also we are gonna create a chiral background of gravitational waves. So I'm not gonna show you the computation of that. It's quite elaborated and still even 10 days after this was proposed, we are still working on the details of this now with lattice simulations. So I'm just gonna show you a picture, a plot I did 5 years ago that represents very well how here you will have the quasi-scale invariant background. Okay, this is a straight line. I'm forgetting the tilt of slow roll. Here is the spectrum today, omega gravitational waves versus frequency. And here is the source, gravitational wave background. You see, it develops a blue tilt because it goes up. The farther up, the higher the frequency. It's actually very chiral, as I said, only one polarization is mostly active. And it's also, and I'm not gonna enter into the details of this, is non-Gaussian. So if we were capable to measure non-Gaussianity of these stochastic backgrounds, something that is extremely difficult and most likely not possible with direct detection experiments, unless you do cross-correlations, and we are very lucky with this, for the amplitude of this background, it looks very unlikely. In any case, if we had the capability in the future, say our daughters, you know, in one century, they developed the ability to measure non-Gaussianity of tensor modes for direct detection of gravitational wave backgrounds, this background would be non-Gaussian, and that would be a very good distinction together with its chiral nature. Okay. So what is really the relevant aspect of this background? Sorry, I anticipated the transparency. It's not so much that it's really non-Gaussian or chiral, all this I'm saying, and it's blue tilted. What is really relevant is that the tilt is so strong that within certain parameter space, it can be directly observable. Which, if you remember, answers precisely the original question I posed at the beginning of my lecture yesterday, which was, what is the ability of gravitational waves to really probe high energy physics phenomena? And here what you are probing is the chiral coupling of a gauge field with a pseudo scalar field, which is an inflaton. Now, that is a very specific model. What if there is an arbitrary extra field species coupled to the inflaton? And I don't invoke any particular symmetry. Okay, I don't invoke now the shift symmetry. So the question is, would I produce large excitation of fields? Will they create gravitational waves as well? Well, let's consider a generic inflaton with whatever potential. Let's couple this inflaton in this dimensionless manner, quadratic part, with an extra scalar field. As you see, I introduced by hand some extra specific scale of the inflaton, phi naught. We do the same with some fermion field. We introduce a Yukawa-like interaction with the inflaton. And, I hope you see the mouse, yes. And we can also consider not the inflaton, because in principle cannot be gauged, but some scalar field there, a spectator field that is gauged under some abelian group and is coupled through normal covariant gauge derivative through a gauge field. And you could think whether this guy could also excite the gauge field. So we are going to ask ourselves, can we excite the scalar field here, the fermion field here, or the gauge field here? Well, it turns out that in all three cases, it is possible to have a non-adiabatic excitation of the field fluctuations of the field species. Let them be scalars, gauge fields, fermions. But this only happens for a short moment of time. Actually the moment during which I verify this condition. And this is why it was crucial to introduce this scale, because phi naught arbitrarily, because essentially you introduce it by hand and you decide in what part of the inflaton potential, when the inflaton crosses this scale, then we produce the violation of adiabaticity that gives rise to a production excitation of the field species. How does it look, this excitation? It creates an occupation number, which has an exponential shape, which means it has support only in the very infrared of the infrared modes below this given scale. But it's okay because this non-adiabatic field excitation, which corresponds to particle creation during inflation, is going to create gravitational waves. So people have worked out the distortion in the spectrum of the otherwise quasi-scale invariant background from quantum fluctuations. And the relative distortion is like a bump. It's like an extra power here that you locate and some frequency that, of course, is related to what is your choice of phi naught and parameters. And, the width and the amplitude is codifying this formula that, of course, you don't need to study because I tell you the answer immediately. Quite unfortunately, the relative amplitude of this kind of excitation of extra gravitons tensors during inflation is absolutely negligible compared already to the quantum vacuum produced gravitons. So this points out the fact that, yes, when we consider extra species, extra fields, if we invoke a shift symmetry, this produces a very special situation, which gives rise to a continuous production of gravitational waves because of the continuous excitation of the gauge fields. And that gives rise to a blue tilt, chiral and non-Gaussian gravitational wave background, which is potentially observable with coming detectors. Whereas if we consider arbitrary couplings of other fields, as we did in the exercise, this produces a localized excitation of gravitational waves. The localization in the spectrum really depends on your choice of parameters, but in general, it's quite a negligible compared to the previous mechanism.
Danny, this is Sriram. Can I ask a question?
Oh, please, go ahead, of course.
What determines where, at what scale that bump arises? What in the dynamics determines the scale at which the bump arises?
Well, essentially, this depends on your inflaton potential. So imagine you have simple form, a polynomial form. Then, you know, your inflaton field is doing the standard slow roll scenarios, a slow motion, no, in this potential. And at some moment it's gonna cross around this scale and it makes the effective mass, for instance, of the scalar chi coupled to phi. This is the effective mass of that scalar chi. It makes it to vanish. So it is in that moment when we have some non-violation of adiabaticity. And therefore, it's up to you where you choose where phi naught is to what scales that corresponds. Okay. Essentially, at the end of the day, everything is encoded here in this formula. This is for the amplitude. For the localization of the frequency, it really depends on your choice of phi naught. And I'm guessing from this formula is around this scale mu, which has to do with the velocity of your field around phi naught and the coupling G, and the coupling G of your strength, which in this case is a scalar coupling like this. But you see, it's the same formula if you want for a mass for the fermions, or it's the same formula if you think of giving mass to the Gauss bosons through this Higgs-like mechanism. So I can check it in the paper, sorry, because I don't recall exactly on the top of my head.
No issues, I understand.
Yeah, but I believe this is the scale at which you locate in commoving scale the bump, okay? But what is certain besides the details is that by choosing the strength of the coupling and the phi naught scale, you can choose where to place it one way or another.
And when you mean non-Gaussianity, you're referring to the tensor, purely tensor non-Gaussianity.
Yeah, when I meant non-Gaussianity here I'm showing the two-point function, no, because that's the spectrum, the expectation value of the quadratic form. But if the field itself of the tensor Hij, no, the tensor perturbation, is non-Gaussian, this means that its probability distribution, of course, has a non-Gaussian tails or non-Gaussian shape, and for instance, three-point function of these guys is non-negligible or non-zero, whereas in a Gaussian field, it would be zero any odd combination of powers. So by non-Gaussian, I literally mean of the tensor field, that's right. Unfortunately, we thought 5 years ago that this was possible to be measured with detectors. People realized later on that it's not easy at all, and the kind of backgrounds you could measure are very difficult to be produced in the early universe, to be honest. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks. There is another question by Deep Ghosh.
Deep, I'm unmuting you. Please go ahead. Unmute yourself and speak, rather.
So, hello, am I audible?
Hello.
Yes. Yeah. So my question is regarding the particle creation you talked about. So. Yeah. As far as I could understand, that the fluctuation in the in inflation field somehow transferred to the gauge field and thus the particle created from excitation. So that also depends on the how much coupling is there between the phi and FF tilde.
Yeah.
You retain. So yeah. Now.
That's encoded here. You see mu depends on the coupling.
Yeah.
And it tells you the cutoff of excitation.
Yeah. So my question is, let's say there is no such portal that phi FF tilde. So from field theory, we can also consider some excitation itself of FF tilde term. So that also creates some exotic photons. So in that way, could we not create a non-zero density of photons in our early universe?
If there is no phi FF tilde coupling,
yes.
If you take a pure electromagnetism theory,
yes.
That is conformal, and there is no possible excitation of the gauge fields. It's not that doesn't happen. You need that coupling to excite them.
Oh, okay.
Or you need another coupling that is of the form F of phi, if you want, times F squared. You see, you need something to break the conformal invariance of a standard electromagnetism or standard gauge theories.
Okay, so
it's crucial to have the coupling, yeah.
So that is, I think, a bit different from what we did in Minkowski and QFT. But So if the underlying space time is Minkowski, then we can excite some photons from if mu nu.
You always have the vacuum excitation, but whether you stimulate them during inflation, that's where you need the coupling. Okay, so if you want, for instance, the quantum vacuum fluctuations I'm referring to here, these are the same as Minkowski initially, because they happen deep inside the Hubble scale where you don't feel the expansion. The difference is that then they are stimulated through the expansion, through the inflationary expansion, and you drive them to be out of a Hubble scale, and you stimulate their amplitude in that evolution. And that doesn't happen with gauge fields unless you have extra couplings.
I see. And this coupling is also can be constant from the reheating temperature, I guess. That
which coupling? This one?
That phi FF tilde?
Yeah, this coupling can be constrained. Can be constrained from three perspectives. First of all, because it produces it produces such a large gauge fields, which are also non-Gaussian, they back react into the inflaton dynamics, and they also produce non-Gaussianity in the scalar sector. They induce a scalar non-Gaussianity. So you immediately can put a constraint on the amount of non-Gaussianity you can tolerate from this. Okay. Secondly, because you excite very much the amplitude of scalar fluctuations as well, you can also put a constraint from the amount of PBH of primordial black holes you would produce. Mm-hmm. And that also gives you a coupling for the upper bound for this coupling. And third, in preheating, in the standard scenarios of preheating, where you assume a power law of this guy after inflation, the amount of gravitational waves you produce from this effect is actually amazingly large, and actually gives the largest upper bound for these scenarios in this coupling here. Okay, so all of these things are taken into account when people do this research. And for instance, when I'm showing you this plot here, we were considering the maximum upper bound tolerated in that moment, which now is slightly lower. The problem that is extremely difficult to deal with these upper bounds, because they require nonlinear simulations or understanding of nonlinear gravity. And that's extremely difficult to deal with.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. So, okay, in summary anyway, because I think that's a very relevant question. There are physical aspects, physical circumstances to put constraints in the coupling that I'm showing here. One comes from non-Gaussianity during inflation. Another one comes from overproduction of primordial black holes, that they represent more of the dark matter than what we see. And the third one comes from preheating, which is more model dependent, but still very strong. Okay. if you want tomorrow, I can give you references for that. Okay, it's a very interesting papers. Okay, so that was one possibility. Another possibility I'm gonna consider is possibilities, the circumstance to enhance scalar perturbations. What do I mean by this? Well, during inflation, if my inflaton potential is actually non-monotonic or is a multi-field scenario, it is relatively simple to enhance for particular range of scales the amplitude of your scalar fluctuation, your curvature fluctuations, the power spectrum. So what we know is what is the amplitude of this spectrum of curvature fluctuations, the power spectrum from CMB, but that's at the CMB scales, which are cosmological scales. Nothing prevents us from assuming that in inflation, maybe the potential of the inflaton develops an inflection point or a not very deep change of the potential, a shallow depth. And all those features can actually contribute to the dynamics in such a way that you produce, enhance very much the amplitude of your fluctuations at those scales. Those scales have to be shorter than those of the CMB. So this phenomena typically happens after the modes of the CMB left the Hubble radius. Now, let's assume whatever the mechanism, that's the case, that we have produced some enhanced scalar fluctuations at shorter scales than those of the CMB. It turns out that our standard linear perturbation theory that I introduced myself in Minkowski, and here is the generalization in Friedman, Lemaitre, Robertson, Walker, which I'm sure David and Will also introduce, is not really enough to keep it at first order, because now you need to go to second order. And when you go to second order, you realize that there are bilinear combinations of your scalar fluctuations that they contribute like if they were an effective source of gravitational waves. So essentially this was realized actually in a pioneering paper by David Wands, one of the lecturers, a few years ago, 15 years ago. And there is a lot of discussion now about this topic because it's quite a hot topic, because this gives the possibility that if you have a natural mechanism to enhance your curvature fluctuations, then this is the same as enhancing these scalar fluctuations you have here, and you produce an extra source of gravitational waves, which could be manifested as a stochastic background in the late universe. So essentially, you can write a complicated formula that I'm not gonna write explicitly because you see already how complicated the source is. And you can write a complicated formula of what is the energy density spectrum of the gravitational waves as a function of the four-point function of the scalar fluctuations. And if you assume these scalar fluctuations are Gaussian, or their four-point function is dominated by the Gaussian part, then you can write the energy density spectrum of gravitational waves as a function of the power spectrum of scalar fluctuations. And using that, we can take upper bounds of the non-detection of gravitational wave backgrounds by different experiments and translate this into an upper bound of the power spectrum of scalar fluctuations at the corresponding scales of these experiments. So this is amazing, you know, because now by not measuring gravitational waves, we put impressive bounds in the amplitude of a power spectrum of scalar fluctuations. Once Lisa flies, the expected sensitivity is of the order of 10 to minus 13 in omega gravitational waves, which will translate for the corresponding scales to where Lisa is sensitive to, which in Hertz, this corresponds to millihertz, it will correspond to an upper bound of the order of 10 to minus 5. If Big Bang Observatory was ever launched or designed, the promised sensitivities of the order 10 to minus 17, you would put an upper bound of the order of 10 to minus 7 in the scalar fluctuations. So this is an amazing technique that people are exploring in the last years. I'm also exploring it myself. I hope in the near future will give us, as we go improving the upper bounds on gravitational wave backgrounds, just from not detection, we will improve our upper bounds on scalar perturbations at the corresponding scales. Now, a very interesting idea, which is also a hot topic, is that if you enhance your scalar fluctuations at some short scales, this may produce primordial black holes. This depends, of course, how big are the fluctuations. In reality, it does not depend, in inflationary models at least, it does not depend really on the amplitude of the power spectrum, but it depends on the non-Gaussian tail itself. But anyways, let me not enter into those details unless you want to ask explicitly afterwards. There is a very relevant question of whether LIGO has detected primordial black holes or astrophysical black holes or both. And well, the answer nowadays, even a few years after we've been collecting observation of black hole binaries, is that we don't know with certainty. We will certainly know by determining the mass spin distribution of all the binaries we are measuring. But if you look at the latest analysis that consider a lot of astrophysical uncertainties in the modeling of the astrophysical black holes and take into account that there is a possible subset of black holes that are of primordial origin, well, they end at the end of the day quantifying what is the possibility or probability that there is a family of primordial black holes among the ones we measure. And in certain modeling, is significant the presence of possibly of primordial black holes. In other astrophysical modelings, you don't need them at all. Okay. There is the circumstance that some of the black hole binaries we've seen, they have very large masses. And it's not easy to explain this with astrophysics. And in particular, there's one example that has really gigantic masses, 90 solar mass and 60 solar mass, the pair of these black holes. And that is really problematic to explain it from a standard astrophysical origin. But in general, if you remove that one event, there is no conclusive conclusion, unfortunately, yet. And of course, some people are pushing to say, yes, there are primordial black holes. But I think we have to be cautious, because it's only by determining with more accuracy the mass and spin distribution that we'll be able to tell something about this. And so far, we have only 49 candidates, which is good enough to start building the mass function of the distribution of these black holes, but it's not good enough to be accurate and precise and to be answering in an accurate manner these questions, this very interesting question. So it remains a possibility. We may have produced primordial black holes by enhancing the fluctuations during inflation. There are several mechanisms to do this. The most relevant one possibly is ultra-slow roll. I'm happy to tell you about it if you want in the questions turn, because otherwise we wouldn't have enough time. Now I'm gonna switch to reheating. I'm gonna finish with inflation. As I said, there are other mechanisms to also enhance gravitational waves. I just told you the ones I like the most. I don't know how I'm doing with time now. Do I have, 10 minutes?
You have about 9-10 minutes.
9-10 minutes. Okay, let me see what I get, because I'm not sure I'm gonna be able to finish. So reheating is the period matching the end of inflation with the thermal expansion history of the universe. And as we will see, this gives rise to new mechanisms of gravitational wave production. So reheating is the period here where the energy density responsible for inflation, once inflation ends, gets converted into particle species, which decay into others, and eventually they thermalize. And in this decay process, if the process are non-perturbative, as it usually happens, when they are non-perturbative, we call them preheating with P, then we can produce gravitational waves, as we will see in a moment. Let me consider very simple scenarios. These are ruled out from the point of view of CMB, but I'm just going to consider these power law monomials for the inflaton during the post-inflationary oscillations. And then we couple the simplest coupling you can think of, quadratic-quadratic interactions of a scalar field chi with the inflaton phi. So we can, study the fluctuations. And what happens is that very typically, the dynamics of the fluctuations of these fields, let me call them the reheat fields, like chi here, are nonlinear, non-perturbative, and far from equilibrium. Okay, so essentially, the fact that it's a non-perturbative effect that excites these fluctuations when you study this whole set of equations is what gave the name of preheating with P. So we speak about preheating as an earlier stage of the reheating whole period when non-perturbative effects are at place. So how do they happen, these non-perturbative effects? Imagine this very simple scenario. We have a monomial for the inflaton after inflation, and the inflaton is going to oscillate around the minimum of its potential. And then there is this coupling, and let's say we rescale chi in such a way that we write a new variable. This represents chi, okay, this capital X in Fourier space, such that its effective mass, you see, it's given by a standard relativistic dispersion relation with the mass given here by the interaction. Okay, the mass is g squared times phi squared. Now, phi squared is rolling and it's oscillating. So as it moves through the potential, when it crosses through the bottom of the potential, it will violate adiabaticity again. And this will translate into particle production. But now, because we are oscillating, contrary to inflation before, the inflaton is going to come back and forth again and again through the minimum of its potential. And we are going to accumulate this non-perturbative production, and we are going to resonate in this production. And this is what is called parametric resonance. So the amplitude of the fluctuations, or of the occupation number, if you want, grows exponentially fast due to the cumulative effect of the inflaton passing successively through the minimum of its potential and making the effective mass of the preheat field to go evolving non-adiabatically. So in other words, this is a natural mechanism just by this coupling, and it definitely happens by any other type of coupling, to suddenly transfer exponentially a lot of energy into the preheat fields. Do I need this oscillation? Not really. There are other mechanisms to have preheating with P. So for instance, in a multi-field hybrid type of scenarios, here we have a valley along which the inflaton is slowly rolling and inflating the universe. At some moment, it hits a critical point given by the parameters of the theory. We don't need to enter into that. But when we hit it here, the effective mass of the so-called waterfall field, which is an extra degree of freedom we have in the game here, coupled to the inflaton, it becomes tachyonic. And if it becomes tachyonic, it means that, again, I'm going to excite it exponentially, pretty much as before. Now, this is actually a phase transition. So this, we are going to keep it, the details of this, for tomorrow, actually. But no matter what's the physics of preheating, at the end of the day, you study oscillator-like equations of this kind with time and scale-dependent frequencies, which maybe are tachyonic, maybe are periodic. But no matter the details, whenever you have any of these circumstances, the solution to this oscillator equation is not harmonic oscillations anymore. It's field fluctuations that grow unstable. So for a specific range of momenta, the amplitude of the fluctuations according to this equation, whenever I have tachyonic or periodic changes in the effective frequencies, the amplitude of the fluctuations or their occupation number grow exponentially fast. And this only happens for a specific range of momenta. So if you now translate this Fourier space picture into real space, into the actual real space, this corresponds to a very inhomogeneous distribution of the fields with a length scale inverse to the scales excited, with high energy density contrast, because you are creating very large inhomogeneities, and with relativistic speeds of propagation. How does it look? This is one example. You create in real space, this is like a cross section of a scalar field in 2D. And what you see is that you create this instability, it grows very fast to a maximum value, then it goes down, then you start creating these other inhomogeneities, and then eventually the whole system becomes inhomogeneous, breaking down in a smaller inhomogeneities. So this kind of physics is the perfect generator of gravitational waves. And this was noticed many years ago, including during the time of my PhD. And multiple scenarios that have these preheating effects actually are creating gravitational waves in a very efficient manner. Okay. Now, I was going to show some simulations here, but since I'm out of time, I'm going to skip it. And I'm just going to show you what is the typical background of gravitational waves you create here. So typical background you create with a single preheat field. So when you couple only one field to the inflaton, is a one bump spectrum of gravitational waves. I'm representing here the spectrum versus momentum at the time of production. For monomial models, so for potentials that have a monomial shape, we have parameterized what is the amplitude of this background and the position of this background. And everything is controlled, the amplitude and the location of the peak of the gravitational wave background, by this so-called resonance parameter that encodes all the physics. The strength of the coupling of the species, G squared, the initial amplitude of the inflaton at the onset of oscillations, and the effective potential of the inflaton during the oscillations through the curvature of that potential. Okay, so once you have a scenario, you know your resonance parameter, you can predict the amplitude of this guy and the location and redshift till today. And the result is that these preheating mechanisms can create extremely large backgrounds of gravitational waves with an amplitude today of the order of 10 to minus 9. Furthermore, if you notice what I was saying a moment ago, if the amplitude of the gravitational wave background for a single preheating species scales with the resonance parameter, and the resonance parameter depends on the coupling on the given preheat species, what happens if you have different preheat species? And I'm going to show you in a moment. If this is one peak signature from a single preheating species, and this is another signal, one peak signal from another different preheat species with a different coupling, let me assume now I couple the two species together with the inflaton, but different coupling, but the same they had when I consider them individually. And what's the resulting background? The resulting background with the two preheat species maintains the structure of the peaks of the original single preheat species. And if I do this with three preheat species, then what I finally identify is a kind of a stairway-like signature where for every coupling of the different, every preheat species has a different coupling. And depending on the strength of this coupling, I produce a peak with a given amplitude and a given location. How easy would it be to identify this with detectors? Well, if we had, for instance, a two-peak structure from two preheat fields with typical amplitude from preheating, but at the LISA frequencies, then this is the LISA experiment noise, projected noise, and you see we can really reconstruct it very well. If we were to do the same experiment with Big Bang Observatory, assuming this whatever bill, the reconstruction would be just perfect of the two-peak structure. So now I show you, instead of the actual spectrum, I show you the actual reconstruction of the couplings, if you want, of the frequency location of the features of the peaks. And you see the reconstruction is of the order of percentage for the first frequency and the second frequency, let's say for the two peaks at LISA. Okay, which means since each location of the peak, it's directly depending on the coupling, we can reconstruct the couplings of the interactions to better than 1%, or at least this is the idea. Okay. Unfortunately, even though our example that we are about to publish, hopefully in January, if not in February, we are almost done with it, our example only serves as a proof of principle, but very unfortunate for these preheating scenarios I'm showing you. In reality, there is no detectors at the very natural high frequencies that they typically create backgrounds. What about multi-field models like the hybrid scenarios? Here, we can also produce very large amplitude, but in order to have it at observable frequencies, you need to do a very fine tuning of some of the parameters involved in the theory. So realistically speaking, you can always produce with preheating large gravitational wave backgrounds, but they are typically peaked at high frequencies where there are no detection technology. Okay. With this, I finish. So what we've covered today is gravitational waves from inflation and from preheating. I'm very sorry I went a bit rushing on the preheating part, you have the simulation anyway in the PDF, so you can see yourself, and you can certainly ask me questions tomorrow, or we can play tomorrow in the turn of questions if you want. And just to mention that tomorrow in the third and last lecture, we will cover phase transitions and cosmic defects. And actually with the phase transitions part, we will continue a little bit with preheating, since in preheating we can also have phase transitions. Okay, but I'm gonna stop here. Sorry, I'm a bit out of time. Thank you very much.
No problem, Danny. Thank you. Thank you very much. Time for questions. Please raise your hand so that I can unmute you.
Deep gosh.
Yes. Let me go to Aman first. Aman, unmute and speak, and then I'll come to Deep. Yeah. Aman, go ahead.
Hello, sir. When we consider gravitational waves from inflation, do we need to worry about the transition from before the radiation dominated era to the radiation dominated era? This should be a period of transition. It should not be a jump like.
Yeah, it's.
Do we care about it?
Yeah, we do care about it. So essentially, here I'm being very schematic with these plots, but in reality, this high frequency n, this corresponds to the end of inflation. So this background goes off exponentially down. Now, if the transition to whatever era coming after inflation happens gradually, then maybe this affects a feature here. And now, once we enter into whatever reheating stage, maybe the universe is matter dominated or quasi matter dominated, or something in between radiation and matter dominated. Or in these very special scenarios called gravitational reheating, actually is stiff dominated. So it really depends on what is your assumption. This impacts directly in the so-called transfer function, and it will really impact on the shape of your background here. So if you want to make a specific prediction for a given expansion history in between the end of inflation and onset of radiation domination, you need to characterize the effective equation of a state during that period. If during most of that period is quasi-constant, then you can apply this formula directly. If it's really evolving in time until it hits radiation domination, then you have to solve the real-time evolution of the tensors living in that evolving background. Okay, and this is totally possible, has to be done in a model by model basis.
Model dependent,
absolutely, because it depends on the instant equation of a state of your expansion history in every moment. Yeah. The advantage of once you enter in radiation domination is that once you enter in radiation domination, even if the universe keeps evolving and doing many things, the equation of a state doesn't change because it's radiation dominated. So it's 1/3, and this gives k to the zero here. And this is why we preserve the quasi-scale invariant. If before we reach radiation domination, there is a history of going through a stiff, then matter, or vice versa, whatever, this really depends on your model, this will be reflected in your in your ultraviolet tail of your quasi, of the not anymore quasi-scale invariant background of quantum fluctuations.
Yeah, okay, thank you.
Thanks, Aman.
Thank you.
Deep, can you unmute and speak?
So my question is regarding that for preheating, you have considered the coupling phi square, chi square.
Yes.
So this coupling also enables a process, depending of course on the kinematic factors, that 2 phi can annihilate into 2 chi. So
yes.
In that way, you can also generate a non-zero density of chi particles. So did you consider that? And second question is that to produce the standard model particle density in the early universe, can we make some call that in which way it has happened, via this preheating or via this direct production from the phi annihilation itself?
Yeah, thank you very much. Very good questions, Deep. So the first question is that, of course, you know, if I think from the standard diagrammatic quantum field theory point of view, which don't forget that is a perturbative approach, that, okay? Yes. Then you can think of two quanta going into another two quanta. That's a perturbative effect, and that's absolutely negligible compared to the non-perturbative excitation of infrared modes due to the variation of non-adiabatic mass of these sky fluctuations. So the point is, perturbative effects are completely negligible, typically, compared to these preheating effects, because the preheating effects are non-perturbative and excite exponentially fast the fluctuations. And you cannot recover, actually, from perturbation theory, these preheating effects, because they are non-perturbative. And it's very interesting, because it's really beyond this perturbation point of view that you learn in your quantum field theory books, no? For instance, think of a waterfall, okay? And from conservation of energy, if you drop a drop of water from a certain height yourself, you let it go, it goes to the bottom of the lake, okay? And then imagine it bounces and comes up. From conservation of energy, it cannot go above the initial height you gave it. But since this is a non-perturbative effect, what we have here is like you drop that drop of water, it goes to the collective motion of the whole lake underneath, and then it throws it up such that it goes at higher heights than originally from the original height from which you drop it. And this is the mechanical analogy to what's going on here. It's like you can produce even particles that are more massive than the original particle. And this is because this is a non-perturbative collective effect, which happens in a time scale much, much faster than the perturbative effects. Okay. And now the second question is, how do we originate the standard model? There is no clear answer to that. It's a very exciting branch of research. It's one of the topics I dedicate most time in my life to understand how the standard model itself originates out of the inflationary background. And there are the possibility to have a direct coupling. This gives a lot of problems because, you know, there is electrowave vacuum instability in the Higgs sector, and it's very difficult to really originate the standard model through these standard parametric resonance effects. But there are other forms to do it. One of them, for instance, I put it forward with Chris Burns 5 years ago, which consists in assuming a non-minimal coupling of the Higgs of the standard model to curvature, and assuming a stiff equation of state after inflation. And this flips the sign of the curvature of the Ricci scalar, and this creates a tachyonic instability in the Higgs sector, which then excites the Higgs, and later on the Higgs oscillates and produces the standard model. It's a model dependent thing. There are other ideas. At the end of the day, it's very complicated to really come out with the standard model and just the standard model. Okay, and it's a hot topic, or at least for the few of us that we work in preheating actively, you know, early universe non-perturbative effects, it's really one of the topics we would like to solve within the next 10, 20 years, at least to have a clear set of answers. Okay. I'm happy to elaborate more if you want tomorrow in the 10 of questions, of course.
Yeah, maybe we can discuss further in this.
Yes. It's an interesting topic to discuss.
Raised hand. Saugata, a brief question.
Yes.
Unmute and yeah, speak. Go ahead, Saugata.
Can you hear me?
Yes. Very weakly.
My question is regarding the axion inflation. So yes. You wrote a term like phi FF dual.
Yes.
And as far as I know, this phi is a QCD action, then this type of term can be generated after pion action pion mixing. So how this type of term can be written in
This is not the QCD action. This is not the QCD action.
Just like an action-like particle.
It's an action-like particle. That's right. Okay. Yeah. Because actually the kind of mass term I need here in the potential to later on create this, it's absolutely incompatible with this being the QCD action. So it's not, sorry, I thought I had a transparency to say that, but apparently I removed it. So yes, this is not the QCD action. Sorry for the confusion.
Okay, thank you.
Not even the dark matter axion-like particle. This is an inflaton axion-like particle that we speculate with. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks for the question.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Danny. Maybe we can stop here.
My pleasure.